God is faithful. Welcome to the First Institutional Baptist Church worship service. I am Warren H. Stewart, senior pastor. All year long, we are thanking the Lord for our journey yesterday, today, and forever. So come on, let's give God some thanks and praise as we worship the Lord today.
Y'all go ahead and give God some praise this evening. And we we get to be here for again for Revival 2024. I was glad when they said unto me, let's go down to the First Institutional Baptist Church to be able to worship the Word of God this morning. Y'all doing all right? Excuse me, this evening. All right. What I want to do is I just want to share scripture with you to help prepare us for this time that we have with revival. And I'm not going to read the whole Psalm 80. It's just three phrases that I want to repeat as we think about being revived, being refreshed, and being renewed unto the Lord. It says this, "Restore us, O God. Let your face shine that we may be saved. Restore us, O God of hosts. Let your face shine that we may be saved. Restore us, O Lord God of hosts. Let your face shine that we may be saved." Let's worship.
How many of you are thankful on today? How many of you are thankful on today? Oh, I don't believe you. You thankful? You thankful? Lord,
the magnificent one, the pure and holy one. He is great. I love you, Lord. 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 Sing. I love you, Lord. I love you.
The more you think about God's goodness, the more you begin to thank him. And the scripture says, if I had 10,000 tongues, I still couldn't thank him enough. What we want to do at this time is begin prayer. We want to begin the service with prayer. Amen. So we asked at this time, we ask that everyone will please stand. And because this is the last night of our revival, if you are here today and you want to represent your family, if your family is here and you want to join hands at the altar, we welcome you. If you want to stand on behalf of you and your family or someone you love, you can feel free to come to the altar too. For those of you online, we welcome you, and as we go to God together, we go continuing with that spirit of thanksgiving, that spirit of worship and praise. So, Father God, we come to you this day in Jesus' name. God, we come to you with thanksgiving on our lips, God. Thank you for loving us so much, God. Lord, the song said, it could have been me outdoors with no food, with no clothes, God. But Lord, we thank you, Lord. Thank you just for the mercies you show towards us each and every day. Thank you for rescuing us out of that situation. Thank you for delivering us, Lord. Thank you for keeping us even when we didn't want to be kept. God, we have so much to thank you for. Thank you for carrying us to this day, this third day of the revival, God. Thank you for allowing us to just be here today, to make it to the house, to be able to tune in online, God, and experience this worship service, God. We thank you for sending us a God-called preacher, God, to bring forth the message to us today, God. We thank you, God, for your goodness and your mercies and your glory, God. We just thank you for so much, God, and we come right now, Lord. We come right now holding hands with and standing shoulder to shoulder with those whom we love, our neighbors, Lord, our relatives, Lord, on behalf of ourselves and others, God. And we pray that this last night of revival, God, that we will take it even higher, God. Lord, that you will speak to our spirit, Lord, that you will speak to our soul, God, and revive every place that is in need of being revived, God. Every place in us, God, awaken the Spirit of God through in us, in our lives, and in us today, God. Let this night
God, take us even higher and closer to you, God. We thank you, God, because you brought us here today. We thank you, God, because you're calling us to a revival at a critical moment, God. It's a critical moment in our nation. It's a critical moment in the world, Lord. It's a critical moment for so many people in their individual lives, God. It's a critical moment even for FIBC, God. But more than that, you are showing us that you are sovereign, God, that you are all-powerful, God, that, Lord, earth has no sorrows that heaven can't heal, God, that earth, Lord, doesn't have something going on that causes confusion in your house, or Lord, so we pray right now that your mighty hand, God, will go over this room, Lord, that go over this online, God, that your mighty hand of healing, your mighty hand of deliverance, your mighty hands of revival, Lord, will just spark in us, God, anew, afresh, God, set ablaze in us, God, that we've never felt. So, Lord, some of us haven't felt joy since we called you our Savior, Lord. Some of us haven't felt the joy of our salvation since that moment we came to you, God. But we come to you right now, Lord, anew, afresh, Lord, ready to receive everything you have for us, God. So we pray right now, God, for all those, Lord, who are holding hands or standing next to someone or even standing on behalf of someone, Lord, who is in need of healing, in need of a family discussion, Lord, a family healing, a family renewal, God, a relationship revive. God, we standing in need, Lord, of those, Lord, who are coming on behalf of someone else, God, because they've been away from your house far too long, God. We are calling on you, God, to speak through us, to use us, even to speak to them, to bring them back to the household of faith, God, because that's who you are, God. The Bible says you are married to the backslider, God. So we pray right now, God, that every person who's a part of your kingdom, Lord, we will come together, God, and praise your name, God. We stand here today believing and already seeing revival in us, God, seeing things differently than what we've seen it before, God, living things differently, Lord, because revival isn't something that happens to us. It's something we have to be a part of, something we have to do ourselves, God. So, Lord, where our feet need to go, would you guide us? Where our hands need to go, would you guide us? Where our prayer and life need to go, would you lead us in that direction, Lord? As we used to sing, may the Holy Ghost lead us all the way, God, from earth to heaven. May it lead us, God, even each day of our lives, each night, Lord, every time we wake up, may you guide us to speak to those people you would have us to speak to. Speak to those relatives. Speak to one another. Speak to our neighbors. Lord, that your love will flow through us, that by this will all people know that we are your disciples because how we love one another. Lord, we pray that your love be revived in this place. Your hospitality, Lord, where we become more hospitable in this place. Those of us who are here from the inside out, work in us, work through us, work around us in our going out, in our coming in. Would you use us like we've never been used before, God? Would you open our eyes to see things differently, Lord, that we will begin to walk by faith even more, Lord, than we did before, God? Would you restore in us, God, the joy that you placed in us when you called us your child, God? Help us where we're weak, God. Strengthen us where we're weak, God. Help us on every side, God. And we believe you. We call on you today, God, because you have all power. We call on you, God, the one who was able to raise Jesus from the dead, God. We call on you, the one, Lord, who has all power, who is sovereign above, Lord above all, God, that in the name of the one who every knee will bow down to, God, every tongue will confess that you are Lord. We call on you today, God. So, Lord, let this service that we enter into, Lord, may this service speak to us. May this service light a fire in us, God, that cannot be extinguished, God. May it light a fire in us that we will go out, Lord, telling the world who you are, telling the world about our testimonies and how we overcame, that we will begin, God, to mend relationships because that's what you came to do, Lord. Mend the brokenhearted, set at captive those who set free who are captive, God. So do that through us and through this body of Christ today, God. We love you. We pray for the service today. We pray for the preacher and the preached word today. We pray for the hearers today, that we will move from hearers category to doers, to excited to do your work, your will, that we will find delight in doing your will, that we will find joy and peace, Lord, in doing what you called us to do, Lord, that change will happen, transformation will happen because of what we do, because of your word that we hear tonight. God, revive us, and we love you, and we will praise you this day and forevermore, God. In the mighty name of Jesus, we do pray. In Jesus' name, thank God. Amen. 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 Can we give God a hand clap of praise today? A hand clap of praise. It's so, so good to be in the house of the Lord yet another day. Right now, we want to, before we greet Five with Grace, we want to recognize all of those visitors who are here today, not only online, but also here in person. So if you are a visitor here at FIBC, would you please let us know just by standing to your feet? All visitors, if you are a visitor here, amen, amen, amen. We see you and we thank God for you. We see you and we thank God for you. There is a gift bag coming around for you just for your presence being a gift to us. We have a gift for you. And inside of that visitor bag is a visitor's card that we ask you to fill out during service and just place in the offering basket before you leave service today. Again, thank you for joining us in this service today. This is the last night of revival, but FIBC is here and we've been here with 118 years. So you can always come back. You can always revisit us again and become a member if the Lord leads you. But we are glad to have you here in this place. This is the last night of revival again. I'll repeat that. Have we been having a wonderful time Sunday, Monday, and now today? With that being said, we want to take time to greet each and every person that we see in this house today. So this is the time where we call Greet Five with Grace. We ask everyone to please stand to your feet, walk around the sanctuary, fist bump someone, high five them, give them a hug, and tell them it's good to see you. Those of you who are online, it's good to see you. Would you let us know you're here by dropping it in the chat? Thank you.
Praise the Lord, everybody. How y'all doing tonight? Come on, wave at me if you feel Jesus in the room. Oh, is that all? Wave at me if you feel Jesus in the room. Amen. I'm thankful that the Holy Spirit and our Lord and Savior is here with us today. Tonight, I don't have my white coat as Dante did last night. however, I just come to admonish us for a moment. Regarding discipleship, this indeed is an evangelism and discipleship revival. And so we want us to be revived in those directions. And so I was asked to just kind of share a bit of the direction and part of the vision of what we do regarding discipleship here in this church. And when we think about discipleship, we look at the root word, which is disciple, which we all know to be a learner and a pupil, one who has a following of a teaching. And so I think if I took a poll in the room tonight and asked if there was anybody in the room that wants to look like Christ, I believe I would see everybody's hand. Yep. But then if I ask the next question, are you willing to do all that the scripture says to get there, how many hands then will we see? And I bring that up because discipleship is a journey of commitment. It is a pedagogy that makes us start where we are in a place and move us to a new place that we will never remain the same. Amen. And so one of the ways that the scripture talks about, Jesus talks about it in Luke of the 14th chapter. He says, if you do not hate father, if you do not hate mother, if you do not hate spouse, child, siblings, you cannot be my disciple. And this word hate is not that word hate that we understand and know it to be. It's the Greek word maseo, which deals with us having a less love for. And so if you do not have a less love for all of those people, and I misquote, and yourself, which means that you and everyone else must be second to the thrust and the movement of what God is doing in us. And so if we are going to be true followers and true disciples of Jesus, we must forsake all. Anybody in the room with me? And so what this is that we are looking and moving toward being like Christ. And in moving and being like Christ, this journey that we're on is a spiritual formational journey. And it's transforming us so that we can look clearly like him. One of the aspects that this church does to make sure that we are in preparation for being who Christ says we should be is by doing that via Christian education. Somebody say Christian education. Christian education, nothing new. Matthew 28:19, after it talks about making disciples, verse 20 starts off by saying, teaching them to observe all that I commanded you. So teaching is a huge aspect of our transformation. And so in that, I want to admonish us that as we are here in this revival, and we are receiving this defibrillating word to charge us to the next place, let us be sure that we are not forgetting that there is a teaching aspect that helps to transform us into who we're supposed to be in God. Amen. I can't hear y'all. Amen. And so we need to be transformed. The preach word is not all. The preached word is great, it's wonderful, it charges us, but it's the taught word that you need to shape your life and get us to where we're supposed to be. And so I am admonishing us to make sure that you rethink about the classes that are available at this church. During our Sunday hour, we have several classes that are available for you to be reshaped. Amen? Amen. And on Wednesdays, we have two classes, hybrid at noon and a Bible study in person in the evening for you to be reshaped. Now, if I asked the question, I said earlier, if I took the poll to ask who wanted to look like Christ, everybody will hold up their hands. Now, if I ask the poll how many attend a Bible study on a regular basis, let's see how that's going to go. Amen. Praise the Lord. I see some hands, y'all. But we should see more. Amen. And so let's make sure we are finding our way to being in a place where we are being taught and reshaped in the Word of God. Is that all right? Amen. Come on, y'all. Let's go higher.
Amen. We want to go higher and higher in discipleship. Thank you, Pastor Cannon, our pastor of congregational care, for guiding us and helping us. I like that word, defibrillate. It's a big word I can't pronounce, but anyway, it means if your heart stops, it shocks your heart back. So we all need to be shocked back. Amen. Amen, amen. And have not we been shocked? I'm not going to try to say that word. Since Sunday morning, on last night, we heard you still got enough. You still got enough. And then on Sunday at 11, we heard by any means necessary. And then at 7:30, we heard we still win. Amen. 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 So we're excited about what's going to happen on tonight and how God is going to use our preacher for tonight. I want you to know I was lobbied heavily today to... said, maybe the Lord is telling you to extend the revival another night. I was lobbying heavily today about that. Amen. 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 But we're going to keep it right now. I don't know if we can handle another night. Anyway, but we're so happy tonight. I'm going to have another doctor in the house to come and present our preacher, Dr. Karen Elizabeth Stewart, who should come at this time. And she's going to present our preacher.
Praise the Lord, everybody. You recognize the task that is before me this evening, and that is to introduce our preacher. However, I think I need to make sure we understand the context of her coming to understand the introduction. She is our revivalist. Revival. Re means to bring back. Vive is to bring back to life. So the revivalist is a catalyst that makes a difference. Now, a catalyst increases the rate of change in a chemical reaction without being consumed. A defibrillator is a catalyst, right? It can create change. But it is not the change. We want her to stay because we feel better together with the power of the Holy Spirit. However, the doctor in the house, the defibrillator, her role is to bring us back to life so that we might leave this place. Wasn't there some other folks who were up with Jesus and say, can't we build some tabernacles and just stay here? We can get comfortable staying here. But she is our revivalist, the person who brings about change, who helps to revive us. And has she not done that over these past few nights? There is a pantheon of preachers that I have, and Dr. Jacqueline Thompson is one of those. I first became acquainted with her in 19-something, or early 2000. When was 2003. She came to be one of our speakers for the dawning of the new day. This is the first time I ever laid eyes on her. And I thought, first, wow, somebody taller than me. And then second, she came and wrecked the house then. Because she served as a catalyst talking about and asking us to do something different. She has preached here several times, and every time she revives us as a congregation. I would ask you to not let this revival opportunity pass you by. She's going to lay a table. She's going to put the defibrillator pads on your chest. She's going to holler clear. And she's going to give you a good thump. My prayer is that you will sit up, stand up, get up, walk out, and make a difference because of what we have heard from this hour revival list. She is my friend, she is my colleague, and I love her dearly. So the next word you will hear after we hear from the music ministry is that of Dr. Jacqueline Thompson.
Just follow Jesus, he will see you through. For him. Together, let's thank God for being a God that knows how much we can bear. Now, let me just say this. It's something about the last night of revival that make you tired. It's not just y'all. It's everywhere. But they sent me, Pastor Tally, turn to the scripture. You all have a theme for the month, and one of your scripture texts is Acts chapter 1, verse 8. And your theme is around thanking the Lord for the journey, around growing and prioritizing, right? That's the theme for the month. And in true Dr. Stewart style, there are a number of scriptures. Because he's been doing that since 2003 when I was here. And we appreciate that. You have a mic, don't you? I need you to read that text. Who has a mic? Because I want to tell you what happens. You know it by heart. I know you do. What it says.
But you shall.
Hold on. Let me do it like the old church. Read. That's how they do it in the holiness church.
But ye shall have power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you, and ye shall be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in Judea and in Samaria and into the uttermost parts of the earth.
That's what it says, but there was a condition on that. And so in the beginning, before you get to verse 8, around that first verse, there's a condition. So what's the condition? What does it say? That they were all together in the upper room on one. Let me tell you what that means. That means some of them wasn't on their phones while the other ones was nodding, while some of them was singing about how much they could bear, while the other ones was clapping, while the other ones was trying to figure out how long we got to be in the room before the Holy Spirit really gonna show up. One accord mean one accord. That means we all doing the same thing at the same time with the same mind for the same purpose. So on this last night, I need to know who came for the purpose of giving God glory. Can we all just be on one accord if you are able? We don't mind. Come on, stand on your feet. Put your hands together. If you're not able, it's okay. We all gonna get there one day. But we need to all be on one accord. Whatever you want for you, I want that for you, and I want you to want that for me. It says we were all in the same place on one accord. Folks, now come on, keep clapping while you're standing and celebrate this wonderful pastor. Amen. Come on, keep clapping. Because I say it, she's a phenomenal woman. And I love her. We thank God for Dr. Karen. Keep clapping. For all of the staff pastors that are here tonight. Amen. Wonderful music ministry. We thank God for them. And for you, my brothers and sisters in Christ. I'm not going to be before you long. I'm just going to share with you one scripture. And I'm going to be out your way. I certainly thank God for the invitation to come back. It has been a blessing to me, as I pray it has been for you, for those of you that are here and joining us online. My heart has been warm because members of our Allen Temple family have been here from Sunday till tonight, and it is doing my heart good. However, there is a scripture text. I just want to drop it in your spirit, and I promise you I'm going to be out of your way. But my flight don't leave. Till tomorrow. And if you didn't tell, I got a little apostolic holiness in my bones. And when I was growing up, we had shut-ins. Y'all don't know nothing about it. And I know the parents is looking funny, but the kids used to lay on the floor. They put sheets on the floor and on the pew. You sleep right there. They would say, you learn your ABCs after you learn Jesus. That's how they felt about it. But our text tonight is coming from the Gospel of John, chapter 11. Just two verses of scripture for your hearing. And the Bible says, Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me, though he may die, he shall live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. Then he asks her, do you believe this? And so I need you to look at somebody next to you and just ask them and tell them, make sure you know. You not talking. Turn around, find somebody else. Just tell them, make sure you know. Come on, point your finger at somebody behind you and say, make sure you know. And so I came across a quote today that informed what I wanted to leave with you this last night. And the quote simply says that identity is an incredible force that controls your entire life. That it's an invisible force like gravity, but it controls everything. And behavioral researchers and behavioral economists support this because they have suggested now for hundreds of years that identity is actually what informs the decisions that we make on a day-to-day basis. That it is your understanding of those unique qualities, those unique traits, those unique skills that make an individual who they are, that actually sets them up for how they move and behave in society. It is a concept that is widely debated in that circle, but I tend to believe it. And one of the ways and one of the instruments that God used to drive it home to me was a movie that came out some time ago. It's an old movie, way pre-pandemic. And what I remember is this particular scene. And in the scene, there is this craft that lands on this body of water. But as it's landing on the side of the mountain, there are these bright colors, and there are people of every hue, and there are markings on their face, and they are singing, and they are chanting, and there's music, and everything is beautiful, and it's bright. And out of this craft exits this young man. He is a prince, and he's getting ready to do battle for his father's throne. He's getting ready to engage in a ritual battle. They called him Prince T'Challa. And so he landed, and he is getting ready to fight for the throne of his father who has passed away. But in this ritual battle, he has to encounter M'Baku. Some of y'all might remember Black Panther. And M'Baku was the leader of the Jabari tribe that resided in the mountains. And so if he was going to win, he was going to have to defeat him in this ritual battle. And he did not have vibranium to help him. If you remember the movie, Jabari was much bigger and he appeared to be much stronger. And they begin to engage in this battle, and T'Challa looks like he's getting ready to lose the throne to M'Baku. But then a woman, because there's always talk to me in the building. Her name was Queen Ramunda. She was his what? His mother. She yells from the side of the mountain, show them who you are. And it was something about her saying those words that stirred up something on the inside of him. And what originally looked like defeat became actually a victory simply because he was reminded of who he really was. There's power in understanding identity. It drove it home for me. But even the gospel writer John understands identity, because he does not take time to tell us where Jesus was born or who Jesus was born to. There are no three magi come bringing gifts. There's no barn. There are no animals. He starts out from the very beginning because he understands it's important for us to know who God and who Jesus really is. So he don't have time to tell you that he wandered off when he was 12. That don't, none of that mean nothing. He starts and says, in the beginning was the Word. Because he wants you to know from the beginning who he is. The Word was with God and the Word was God. Then he goes on to say that no man has seen God, but it's been revealed through the Son. Because John understands there's no room for confusion. You need to be able to read my gospel and know exactly who Jesus is. Because he's suggesting that it's the identity of Jesus that's actually going to be his superpower. Because researchers say it is impossible for you to act outside of your identity. That whoever you identify yourself as, it is impossible for you to act outside of that. That's why I don't need no help praising God. Because I'm a self-identified praiser. I don't need no music. I don't need no worship leader. I don't need no prompting. I don't need anything. Because I got a memory. And when I think about the goodness of Jesus and all that he's done for me, my soul cries. And some of us need a memory, because life comes to erase our understanding of the identity of God. It comes to challenge our understanding of who God really is. And so the gospel writer begins to write and prove his thesis. He starts from the beginning. Don't be confused. He's God. And he says, I'm going to prove it to you because I'm going to lay out for you what it is that he does. He does the things that God does. That's why it's difficult to believe in false gods, because they don't do the things that God do. Only God can protect. Only God can provide. Only God. So that's why in John chapter 2, he starts off with the miracle at the wedding of Cana. Because he wants to establish he's God. And so he's going to take something and make it something else. Because that's what God does. Look at your neighbor and say, that's what he did with me. I was a sinner sinking deep in sin. But he took something and he made it something else. That I didn't always look like this and act like this and have what I have. But God took me and made me into something. Because that's what God does. Then he goes on and he tells of other things that God does. And so he talks about how he feeds the 5,000. Because that's what God does. He takes things and he multiplies them so that everybody can be blessed. That's what a God does. Can anybody say God's done that in my... Then he goes over to the pool of Bethsaida and sees a man laying there and heals him after he's been there 38 years. Because he's trying to prove to you that God is the God of time. And it don't matter how long the situation has been in place, that because he's God, he's still able to deal with the situation. Because that's what God does. Then he goes on. And he heals the blind man. Because only God can give you vision. Now keep in mind, the reason why this is a real miracle, because it's not that he's restoring sight. This man has been blind since birth, which means he lacked the ocular capacity to be able to see. So the miracle wasn't restoration. The miracle was creation. that I'm going to place on the inside of you that which was never there, that you might be able to do that which you have never done. He's establishing who God really is. But the thing about it, and the reason I got excited, Kendall, is because I had to tell John, because John and I were talking this afternoon, that even though you wrote it, I don't need to read it because he's been all that to me. He's multiplied things in my life. He's healed things in my, I wonder if I'm by myself. Is there anybody that you can say God has opened some doors and God has made a way and God has worked some miracles? And when I didn't feel like getting up, God touched my body and gave me power to be. Because he's trying to remind you of who God really is. Because the enemy comes to cause you to question, do I really know? That's the issue in the text. Because the Bible says that Jesus and his disciples are returning. And he got word from a family that he loved that Lazarus, his friend and brother, was sick. The expectation, because this is not a stranger Jesus. This is not Jesus that we see every once in a while. This is not Jesus that I pass the grace to two times a year. This is the Jesus that sat in my house. This is the Jesus I fried fish for, him and his disciples. This is the Jesus when my sister sat at his feet while he talked. And so there is expectation when you have relationship. So the Bible says she sent a word and said, your partner, I'm sorry, that's Oakland, your friend is sick. And the Bible says Jesus said, okay. And he stayed where he was 2 more days. I can handle God saying no. I can handle God saying not now. But sometimes it is the delays of God that causes me to question. If you would just deny me outright, I could tend my wounds and get over it. But you leave me in this place of limbo. And I don't know if you're coming. I don't know if I'm going. I don't know what to do. And he said to the disciples, this sickness is not unto death. It's for the glory of God. And it messed me up because it don't feel like glory when you in it. It feels like torture when you in it. But the Bible says he stayed where he was 2 more days. And it was only when he was sure that Lazarus was dead that he said to the disciples, let's go. Because sometimes God has to show you that in comparison to his identity, your knowledge, your identity, your power, your connection, your Rolodex don't mean nothing. So he has to wait till you get to the end of your means before he decides to actually show up and deal with the situation. The Bible says he shows up and Martha said, had you been here, my brother would not have died. Had you been here, the situation would have turned out different. Had you been here, my son would still be here. Had you been here, I wouldn't have had to struggle all those years. Had you not delayed your coming and come when I called on you like they told me to in vacation Bible school, I would not be in this situation. And then he says, I am. The resurrection and the life. He who dies in me will live again. Do you? Because that is the question we're going to have to answer to. Do you believe this? The challenge is, what researchers have also told us, is that oftentimes we struggle in our faith because how we see ourselves, we project onto God. And so if we feel negative about ourselves, then we see a God who is angry and who is mad at us and who is vengeful. But when we begin to understand that our identity does not inform God's identity, but God's identity informs our identity, then you begin to understand that God can't be nothing but God. He don't bless you just to bless. He can't help but bless you because he's God. He can't help but provide because he's God. He can't help but protect because he's God. He can't help but to show up because he's God. The Bible says, after Lazarus was good and dead, Jesus said to the disciples, roll out. Because what we need to be reminded of in these days and times is that no matter what the situation is, God always shows up. And some of you have been wondering, is God going to do it? Is God going to change it? Is God going to fix it? God can't do nothing but fix it. He's God. That's who he is. That's his identity. And I know you don't believe it, but it was them three Hebrew boys that got thrown in the middle of the fire. But when they looked in there, he said, I saw four, and one of them looks like the Son of God, because God always shows up no matter where you find yourself. David said, if I make my bed in hell, I need a few folk that can say, God, I thank you that you with me right now. That even when I can't sense you, I know you with me, because I should have been crazy a long time ago. But if you had not shown up for me and was keeping me in spite of me, I need a few folk to say I shouldn't even be here right now. But God showed up for me in ways that I didn't. You got to make sure you know who he is. He is the God that will always. The Bible says, somebody told Mary, and Mary had my spirit. She had been in the house grieving, because I'm devastated that you would let my brother die. I spent my good perfume you talked about, taught scripture. It was good perfume. Y'all dance around it, the alabaster box, and poured it on your feet, and took my good hair, my 30 inch I ordered off the internet hair. And washed your feet with my Sunday hair. And you mean to tell me that when I ask you to come, you don't come? The Bible says she shows up and says, had you been, my brother would not have died. Because sometimes the reality of life makes you forget every good thing that God has ever done. Which is why your daily life is always about a reminder of who God is. Every day is your rehearsal of the good things that God has done, so you don't give place to the enemy to begin to play with your mind. God, it's not a good day today, but I thank you for all the other days where it was a good day. I thank you for keeping me through the bad days so I can live long enough to see another good day. God, I thank you that when I was so consumed with grief and I didn't feel like getting out the the bed. You let me lay in the bed and kept me anyway and gave me strength to get up and keep on moving. You got to remind yourself. He showed up, but not only does God show up, we have to remember who he is. He is the God that shows up and already knows the outcome. He said over here with the disciples, this sickness is not unto death. But over here, Lazarus is dead. But he said, stand up, Pastor. This sickness is not unto death. But Lazarus is dead. But he said, this sickness is not unto death. But I'm over here, and Lazarus is dead. But what I don't realize is, all this is the journey from what God said to what I'm experiencing back to what God said. So sometimes I can't be focused on what's here. I got to go back and get what God said, so I can begin to see the situation the way he said the situation was going to turn out. Because from the very beginning, God already knew the plan. That's why he can say all things work together for the good of them who love the Lord, who are called according to his purpose. So you can hate me, you can malign me, you can lie on me, you can castigate me. By the time God gets finished, it's still going to promote me and elevate me and work out for my good. I need some of you to celebrate your enemy. Because we pray for the table, but God only prepares the table in the presence. So I thank you, high school counselor, for thinking I wasn't good enough. I thank you, all of those who didn't think I wasn't going to make it. I thank you for those who tried to. I got to remind myself of what he said over here when I'm experiencing that over there, until I've reached the point where instead of saying what I'm experiencing, I am now saying what he said. Where I'm looking at a dead situation and saying, but God said the sickness is not unto death. And I'm going to speak and believe the sickness is not unto death until God shows up and causes the sickness not to be unto death. Because God knows the outcome. He's Alpha and knowing the beginning from. So can I say this? And you don't know this. And if I'm out of order, you know, I've already been out of order since Sunday, so I leave tomorrow. So January, what was it, 2023? You all were so gracious to PNBC, and you hosted us for Midwinter Board. And we're so very grateful that you all did that. You were so kind to us. And I remember in one of the services, my brother Kendall was upset. He was very, very, do you remember? He was very, very upset. And I had wandered out. And I'd never seen him like that. I've been coming here for a long time. And I'd never seen him like that. And he was emotionally upset. You remember, Brent? And I stopped. And I said, what's going on? And he told me. And we prayed. I had not seen him since then. And so what you don't know is that I had to hold myself back. I had asked Pastor because I hadn't seen him until Sunday. And he was doing what he always been doing. And I said, well, look at God. Because I know what we prayed. And I know what we said. And so when I was looking at him, I said, look at God's word coming to pass. You better keep him. You better preserve him. You better use him for your glory. You better taunt the enemy, God. Look at him. As he lift his hands and led the people of God in worship. God, strengthen him right now. Because God knows the outcome. He knows the plan from the very beginning. And sometimes it's the process that God takes us through to get us to this final place. The Bible says he's the God who shows up. He's the God that knows the outcome. That's why when he says train them up in the way they should go, it don't mean they won't stray. It means before it's over, they'll be back. And you're going to live to see it. Speak it over your kids. They'll be back. And I'm going to live to see it. Speak it over your own grandkids. They will be back. And I'm going to live to see it. As a matter of fact, God, I'm going to thank you right now like you've already done it. Because they will be back. And I'm going to live to see it. The Bible says. Martha said, now look. You here now. And I know God will do anything that you ask him to do. Because it still had not registered with her who he really was. He was a friend of the family who had gifts and skills. He could teach and he could help people. She knew he worked miracles. They had heard the story. But it was one thing that she hadn't experienced him do. She had the creation miracle and the multiplication miracle and the restoration miracle, all of those seven miracles that the Gospel of John lines up. But this last one is the one that she needed to solidify her understanding of who he was. He said, I am. She said, I know in the last days, I'm going to see my brother again when he'll be resurrected. She said, mm-mm. She don't know that he had said, this sickness is not unto death. Lazarus is dead, wrapped in cloth, inside the tomb with a stone. You don't get no debtor. And in Jewish culture, they believed that after the third day, it was impossible for you to come back because your spirit had already. She said, I know I'm going to see him when we have the resurrection of the dead at the end of time. He said, mm-mm. This only happened to prove to you who I am. I am the resurrection and the life. And so she still, do you believe it? Okay, all right, well look. Rolling Stone, get. Lazarus, come out. And the scripture said, not only did Lazarus get up and come out, but they had to get some people to unwrap him so he wouldn't suffocate and die again. Because God is not only the God that shows up, and God is not only the God that shows up with the outcome already known in advance, but God is the only one that actually has the power to cause what it is that he said to actually actually become reality in your life. So he comes out. Everybody sees it and begins to rejoice. And they now understand who he really is. Do you believe this? That there is nothing dead in your life that God can't resurrect. That there is no situation that God does not have the power to change. That there is no need that God is not able to meet. That there is nothing that God is not able to address. Because in the end, sometimes the things that happen in our lives is not even about us. All it is God using us as an example to confirm who he really is. How would you know he was a healer if you ain't never been sick? How would you know God is a provider if you never had a need? How would you know God is a waymaker if you've never had an obstacle? How would you know that God is a warrior if you've never had to fight? How would you know that God is able to deal with your enemies if you've never had an enemy? How would you know God is a keeper if you've never felt like you were losing your mind? I need a few folk to say, I don't give God glory for what he's done. I give him glory for who he is. It's because he's been that to me, that he's been my resurrection, and he's been my provider, and he's been my miracle worker, and he's been my way maker, and he's been the one that is keeping and sustaining me right now. But make sure you know who he really is. So when the enemy comes to say, will he? Won't he? When? How? You can say like Job, though he slay me. I don't need everybody, because this last night ain't for everybody. But I need a few saints with the job. Though he slay me, I need to know where you're at. Yet will I trust him. That if it never turns out the way I want, I'm still going to give him glory. Because I know who he is. Even if I got to struggle for a while, I'm still going to praise him because I know who he is. And there's no demon in hell that can change my mind about the God I serve. Is there anybody that loves him enough to give him glory? Anybody that loves him enough to give him honor? Anybody love him enough to give him praise? To say, God, I thank you for who you've been. I thank you for who you are right now. I thank you for who you're going to be in my future. I thank you that the best is yet to come. I thank you that you're not finished with me yet. And little did they know, all they got was a preview of what he was getting ready to do for himself. Because he was dead in a tomb with a stone and a soldier. Spirit already gone. Because on the cross he said, Father, into thy hands I commend my spirit. So if I look at it, there should have been no way that he should have been able to come back to life. But when you know who he is, how could he not come back to life? Because it's impossible for him to act outside of who he is. So if he's the resurrection, then sooner or later he gonna be resurrected. Because that's who he is. And the challenge I leave for you in these days to come, when I'll see you from a distance and on streaming, make sure you know not your pastor's faith. Not your parents' and grandparents' faith. Make sure you know who he really is to you. Because the faith of your neighbor can't keep you when it's you. The knowledge of the pastor of discipleship can't help you when it's you. It has to be some things you know for yourself. That is how our people were able to know that slavery, chattel slavery, was not God's plan. They didn't know the language, but they knew God. So it didn't matter what you preached, didn't matter what you said. They knew the God they served wanted freedom for them. So they sang "Swing Low, Sweet Chariot, coming for to carry me home." They gave instruction to each other, saying, "Wade in the water." They even made quilts that were actually maps, pathways to freedom, and gave them to each other because they knew who God was and that he was a God of freedom and liberation. And when you know who God is, you can't help but to live out what you know. Because Paul said, it is no longer I who lives, but it's Christ that lives in me. And you ought to want your identity to be wrapped in somebody that's as powerful as that God. So if any man be in Christ, they are a new creature. All things, and all things have become new. And when your identity is hidden in that God, there is no issue to say, "I will bless the Lord, oh my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy name." It becomes easy to look at the things that happen and say, "They just don't know who he is." And that means they don't know who I am. Because if they knew who he was, they would know who I am. And they would recognize this is not the path you should take. It becomes easier to pray for enemies and to bless those that curse you when you are secure in your knowledge of who God is. And we are living in times where you're going to need to know who your God is. So I leave you with the challenge, make sure you know. Not just in church every day when you wake up, make sure. Download a devotional to your phone. I'm sure your new app got something because your pastor believes it. Make sure you know. And the good thing about God is that if you say, "God, I'm not sure," make yourself known to me. The Lord will do it. Now, you got to be careful, because when you do that, you're making a commitment. I remember that same college story, and I'm out your way. I was in my last year at Berkeley. My financial aid had run out, and I wasn't going to be able to graduate. And I pulled over on the little side of my car, and I grew up in church where the deacons would pray in the onlyest way they knew how. We didn't have praise and worship. We had devotion. And every deacon, scripture, prayer, song, scripture, prayer, song, scripture, prayer, song. I pulled over in my little car. I had a red Camaro Z28. And I said this to the Lord. If you are real, I was raised in church all my life. If you are real, I need you to get me out of this. And I said, if you get me out of this, I will serve you for the rest of my life. I was 20. I was just praying the way. But the Lord said, gotcha. I went to campus that next day and I was standing in the financial aid line and a lady leaned back and she said, Jackie? I said, yes. She said, what you doing here? I said, I do money to go to school. It's a line of people in front of me. She said, girl, come here. She took me to the back past all of those people. I did not know this lady, but she knew me because she was a member of my father's church and had seen me grow up, and I wasn't at my father's church. I had never seen this lady in 3 years, but right when I prayed that prayer and said, prove yourself, here she come. She said, do you have tuition? I said, no. She said, you have housing? No. You got a food plan? No. You have a book stipend? Mm-mm.
Jesus.
When she pressed enter,
yes,
my last year was completely prayed for. You gotta know. The God that you serve. Come on, everybody standing. We're changing. Help me, Kendall. I will bless the Lord.
Oh, my soul.
That's it. And all.
Your testimony, God has done great things.
Oh, he
Yes.
Lord, we bless your name. We bless your name. Lord, we bless your name.
Have your way, oh God.
We bless your name. We bless your name.
Hallelujah, Jesus. There's none like you, oh God, we bless your name. Without providing somebody an opportunity to get to know that Jesus for themselves. And so if by chance you are here tonight, I didn't see who was visiting, or even if you are a member, because you do know you can be baptized, be a member of a church, and still not know who he is. So if that's you tonight, there are clergy that are standing here. This is your opportunity to come. Now, here is where the enemy says, you can't walk in front of all them people. What are they going to think? You've been here this whole time. But remember, it's not about people. The only one that is the resurrection and the life is the one that you ought to be concerned tonight. So we don't want you to go and not be sure. So if you say, I'm not sure I know, we want you to be sure you know. So this is your opportunity to come so that you can know. And so they're going to hum a little bit, sway a little bit. And if that's you, this is your opportunity. Say, excuse me, I need to go down there because I want to be sure that I'm sure that I'm sure that I'm sure that I know. If you need the Lord to come into your life, this is your opportunity to come. And third invitation, there are many churches. No perfect churches because there are no perfect people. But First Institutional is a wonderful church for you to make your church home. And so if you know but you don't have a church home, I see you coming. Come on, baby, bring everybody. They got a wonderful family ministry. It's a wonderful place, I can testify. Amen. If there's another, we just gonna sing and praise God, and this is your opportunity to come. Amen. And somebody get the babies. Hey, baby. You are the only living God. You are
the only living God.
Oh, yes, you are. For those who have come, Pastor, can I do one last invitation? I promise you I'm done. Let me see everybody who's standing down here, because I don't believe in no foolery when it comes to the things of the Spirit. So if you are here and you have a situation and you want one of the clergy to pray with you about it, I want you to come, because we don't want to leave revival carrying the same burdens we brought to revival. So if you know the word, the prayer, raise your hand so people will know. Amen. So the people will know to come. So if you got a situation, come on. Come on. And let somebody pray with you. Amen. You're the only.
For prayer. Anyone else for prayer?
You may be seated.
Aren't you glad that God shows up? And God already knows the outcome. Do you believe this? Whatever is going on in your life, can we thank God for Dr. Jacqueline A. Thompson, who has blessed us on this night? Amen, amen, amen. As they're praying, we're praying for those who've come down. Our ushers are getting ready to bring the basket. We're going to receive an offering. We're going to be on our way. Once again, God has confirmed that He would have us to be together these last four worship services and to hear His word preached by Dr. Jacqueline A. Thompson. And we're going to just turn around. Ushers, just come. Those who have to give, this is the last opportunity to give. If you want to give online, we have a FIBC Cash App. You can go to your church center Cash App and just where it says general offering, you may give electronically. But if you have to here today, just come and then we're on our way after this. Amen, amen. Can we thank the Lord for everybody involved in helping us to have revival from the moment, from preparing for Dr. Thompson to come to us, even through tomorrow when she goes to the airport, everybody in between, all the ministries, all the people, can we thank God? Come, let's give a God hand praise for that, and certainly includes our preaching. Let's stand on our feet. I'm going to pray a prayer that the Holy Spirit will seal all that we have heard, all that we have felt over these last four worship experiences. God, we thank you for revival at FIBC, the first time we have gathered together on a two consecutive weeknights since before COVID-19. We thank you that you showed up and you showed out. And as the preacher said tonight, you already knew the outcome. And so we look back on the first message, we still win. May all of us leave here knowing that we still win. You have the power to defeat whatever giants are in our lives. And then let us remember that from that Gospel of Mark passage, the preacher told us by any means necessary, we have to have vision, we have to agree together, and then we have to take action. And then when she told us last night, you still got enough. Just keep those empty vessels so God can pour into our lives. And then tonight she raised the question, do you believe this? And we already know the outcome. And we know that you showed up and showed out. So God, we ask you to touch Dr. Thompson as she has poured out to us. Return to her 100-fold. In spirit, in whatever she needs as she goes back to Oakland and to the Allen Temple Church where she serves as a senior pastor. We pray for all of us that we will retain everything that we have received and that it'll manifest in our lives. Thank you for our guests. Thank you for our visitors. Thank you for our ministries. Thank you for our members. Thank you for those who watch virtually. Thank you for those who were in person. We go down from this place, but never from your presence. And we offer this in the matchless name of Jesus Christ. May we say our strategy together. We love everybody. We grow individuals. We share Christ. We set people free. God bless you. Traveling great.